I got one. Hey, I think I got one. No, wait. Hey, hey, it's biting big. Hey, good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the next edition of Pennsylvania Pierce. Wait, hold on. I got away. Another one got away. Good evening, folks. Welcome back to another edition of the Pennsylvania Pickers. Tonight, we have a treat for you. This is episode number 7 of what we've been doing each month now. And what we're doing is a different topic each month. As you see, we bring actual items in and set up a studio so that we can talk about these items and their values. Tonight, we've got a show planned for you. You can pick your friends, you can pick your nose, but you better pick the best seat in the house, because tonight, we've got the best in vintage fishing and a very, very special guest. This man is known as the Stonefly Guy, and ladies and gentlemen, this man needs no introduction, but we've got one heck of a show in store for you. So, yeah, as you can see, the fish have been biting, and you know, with this thing that's keeping everybody at home, what better time than to pick up a hobby doing some fishing? And, you know, the collectible fishing market, people don't understand. Some of this stuff, when it was made one of a kind and by hand out of items that you're going to learn about tonight with our special guest. So at this point, I want to introduce to you the Stonefly Guy.
How you doing? Yeah, John asked me to come on and bring some vintage fly fishing equipment around. I've been fishing my whole life, and as you can see, I'm not a youngster. I've been fishing for probably 65 years. Throughout the years, I've just collected different pieces of fishing equipment, and I saved them. And I just kept things around, and because I liked them, and you know, I've come across old fishing rods and lures and reels and so forth from people that were throwing them away and didn't know what they had. But there is a collectible market in these this equipment. Some of the old lures, as you see down here on the table, if you could, okay, they're made out of wood yet. A couple of the lures here are called Rapalas. It's a famous fly, lure that's sold in most department stores, but now they're made out of plastic. The original Rapalas were made in Finland from a guy named Lauri Rapala. He used a cigarette pack, and he would punch with a nail head pieces of the cellophane into little pieces of balsa wood and troll with those behind his boat. He was a fisherman there, and he would lay nets out to catch whiting. At the end of the day, he would go out and catch whiting, but with these lines that he was trolling, he was catching trout, and he got more money for the trout. Hmm. And people start hearing about this famous lure that he makes, so he became famous in Finland first because other fishermen were coming to him and asking him to make them lures. Well, some representative from America got over there, and that's the end of Lauri Rapala. He became a multimillionaire, and his lures are still sold today. Of course, he's dead probably now for 10 or 15 years.
But starting out from a cigarette pack foil, ain't that amazing?
Yep, yep.
Unbelievable.
Yep. So, you know, I had, like I said, I have an assortment of different old fishing stuff. Look in your basements. See the old boxes that your grandfather left. You can find some treasures in there. Especially nowadays, people are fly fishermen. And there's old fishing poles put away, pieces of bamboo, like this one here. Okay, bamboo fly rods used to be like the thing to have right after World War II. Then fiberglass came into play, and now graphite came in.
Right.
And the graphite fly rods are incredible. I mean, bamboo rods, they start to get memory. They start bending and bowing, and they crack sometimes, and you have to rewind the eyelets, and they become heavy even. But graphite, of course, is real easy to work with, so everybody gets graphite now. So the old fly rods, now this one here, you can see it has a wooden handle. Most fishing rods have cork handles. And also you can see the size of the reels were very small. These are a few fly reels right here in the front. They were very small because they didn't fish in big streams. They only fished in little brooks and so forth. So now these rods have become collector's items because no one makes them anymore. Ones that are made, brand new commercial fly rods, are probably $2,500 or more.
Really?
Yeah. They've become real expensive.
So you don't buy that at Walmart to go out for a bucket of worms.
If you can find an old one and pay $100 for it,
you got a deal.
You got a deal.
Right.
Yeah, definitely.
Right. That's amazing. So were there any famous people in like our nation's history that did this type of fishing?
Oh, yeah. Some of the past presidents fished up in the Poconos. That's where I fish all the time. They fished a stretch of the Broadhead Creek, and they called it the Miracle Mile. There's also an old hotel there called the Henryville Inn.
Right.
And they named the fly after that, the Henryville Special.
Right. It's a fly. And that was one of the better hot spots in the country for fly fishing.
Yeah, but it's private. The president turned that land over to a couple friends of his, bought that area. It's like 13 miles of pristine water called paradise.
So just like you have presidents at golf, you have the ones that were out there doing fishing.
Teddy Roosevelt went there to the Henryville Hotel. Calvin Coolidge went there. Now our modern presidents, President Ford, President Clinton, they fish at Fishing Creek out in Penn State in Bellefonte.
Okay.
Fisherman's Paradise.
Right.
That's their new hot spot that they go to. But this old mountain stream has a lot of history in it. Just as these old fishing items do.
Right.
They're not only an old item that you could say, oh, this is an old antique collectible. You don't know the stories that came from these fishing
rods. How many fish got away, or what they caught.
What fish they caught, what fish they lost, where they went, what streams or any place that they fished in. So there's more to collecting these than the colors of them and who wants to buy them and give you the most money. Some of them mean a lot because they're, like John said in the beginning, there's only a few of them made at a time of a certain kind. For instance, I have one here. It's a special lure that it swims sideways like a dead fish. Instead of it being straight up and down this way, like a normal lure would go, this one swims sideways on its side. So it looks like something that died. About to die in the water,
right?
So it makes it more appealing
to fish.
So again,
for those just tuning in, learning about this, what they were actually doing is creating an artificial type of an object that would attract the fish as if it was a natural type of a bait.
Right.
And that started a whole new industry.
Yeah, they did it. They carved it out of wood first, and they hand painted them.
Right.
Nowadays, like I said, everything's made out of plastic. And they can spray them and put decals on them and make 100,000 of the same kind.
But you don't know if it's going to catch fish or not.
Some of them do. You know, if they're fished properly, you can still catch fish on them because they catch fishermen more than they catch fish.
Right.
Plus, they cost a lot of money now to buy a lure.
It's the market of it, right?
Oh, yeah. I mean, they're $12 to $15 sometimes for one bass plug. And if you throw it and cast it up in a tree somewhere...
So these items being 50, 7,500 years old, are those newer ones going to be as valued like these, or are they not going to be as valued?
I don't think so, because they'll still be making them.
Right, they're mass produced.
They won't become an antique anymore.
So this type of stuff is what's always going to increase in value.
I mean, like baseball bats, they're making fewer wooden baseball bats anymore, you know, because they'll use titanium or whatever else, and... things are becoming modernized for lasting a long time. These older lures, even though they have some prestige to them, they started to rust. They started to fade in color. They didn't have the modern type of paints and lacquers that we have now.
So that's where plus if you lost in a tree or something, you'd be out quite a few bucks.
Oh, yeah. I mean, these are more for looking at and enjoying what... used to be in fishing.
Well, that's what I thought when I mentioned about bringing you on is that I wanted to let the audience know that, you know, this is one of the things that's in the collectible field that most people wouldn't realize. That you just don't put a hook on it and get a bag of worms and go out there and try to catch fish. That there's a whole collectible field behind this, and some of these are worth quite a bit of money.
Oh, yeah.
And like you said, it's in their basements and things. But now, my curious thing that I'm sure a lot of people wonder about is the flies. Tell us about it, how you got into tying the flies and what's involved with some of these.
Well, these flies here, okay, of course they're calling me the stonefly guy. These are a representation of an insect that grows in the water. Underwater, there is aquatic insects. They look like little nymphs or little larvae, little bugs, and they'll eventually hatch, and they come out of water just like mosquitoes do. There's mayflies, there's caddisflies, and there's stoneflies. Those are the three main basic groups. I mean, you see damselflies flying around, or everybody calls them dragonflies, but those came from underwater first. Just as a helgramite does, too. It becomes a Dobson fly.
And it's part of the food chain.
Right. It's part of the fish's food chain every year. So these stoneflies became very interesting to me, and I used to tie different kinds of stoneflies, and I'd look at the live ones. I'd find them under rocks, or if I caught a fish sometimes, we'd cut their stomach open to see what was inside of them once we cleaned them, and I could always find these big stoneflies inside the fish's stomach. So I start tying with string and, you know, fly tying. I start tying different versions of a stonefly until I came upon a very easy natural material to use to make my stoneflies and have the material hold up. Feathers and fur, after fish bite them several times, they start getting tattered and they start ripping apart. Well, I used a shower curtain to make part of my fly. Now it gets wet all the time. You know, you can cut it out into different shapes. So I use a shower curtain for backing on my stoneflies. Now, of course, I have a whole combination of different things I use to tie them, but these are some examples here of the stoneflies. Now you can see it's a very big, it's not a small fly. It's a big type of fly. I don't know if you can see that there. Okay, but you can see right here, it looks like a pretty good sized insect.
Yeah, it does. All from right. here, it looks actually like a live insect.
Right. Now, these things go down and they bounce along the bottom of the stream, and when it comes time, they crawl out on a rock, and they split open just like the locusts do, or the, what are they called?
Cicadas, right.
Cicada, right. They climb out and they crack open. Same thing with these. This is in the nymph stage, and it'll crawl out on the rocks, crack open, and become a fly. Then it mates, lays eggs, and dies.
Same thing all over again.
There's the time to get them is when they emerge from the bottom. Then when they fly around, of course, you can't catch them. But when they mate and they go down and they lay on the water, then you can catch them again. Okay, it's a different time that you can catch them.
So the idea being, once they hatch and the fish are hungry for them, you want to be fishing with the stonefly at that point.
When they're coming out of the water and crawling up on the rocks, it's easy for them to come right along the shore and bite them right up.
Right.
So I used to use the stoneflies quite a bit. I liked fishing with them. You know, it was easy, one big fly on, and I'd cast it and just drift it along in the water, and the fish, I just seemed to have a knack for when they picked it up, when they bit it. Right. Because they only bite once, and they spit it out. But where I fish in the Bushkill Creek up in Marshall's Creek, Pennsylvania, a lot of the old fishermen that used to be there every week started recognizing me and seeing me catching fish. And a guy came up to me one day and said, "You're that stonefly guy, aren't you?" So, you know, I start taking on the name.
You
I'm the stonefly
right?
guy
right.
there.
Now, were other people tying a stonefly, or were you the first one?
Well, yeah, there's different versions of them. There's a lot of different representation. Actually, I have a whole book here. You know, I bought books to read and see what other people had to say about them. Well, sometimes what you read in a book, I think, doesn't always do you too much good, because now I know too much about them.
Right.
You know, I know when they're not going to bite, when they are. But before, when I was just kind of young and I just went out there and fished with them and thought I was going to catch fish, I always did.
So it's like not
like I said, there's so many different kinds. You know, I start trying to get, you know, creative and try different versions of them and so forth. But basically, I go back to my same one stonefly and still do pretty good.
And what type of fish are you catching with them?
Trout, basically.
Okay, just so the audience knows
that. Even in New York State, I use them sometimes for steelheads. Steelhead are a breed of trout that come into the Salmon River after the salmon eggs.
Right.
And they eat salmon eggs and stoneflies while they're in there. And that's usually one of the things I'll use then.
So why don't you share with the audience about some of the salmon fish that And the, was it two times a year that they come in up in New York?
Yeah, yeah, everybody. Well, what,
the size of these things.
If any of you people fish, you know, if you've ever gone up to New York. Now, Pulaski, New York had a bad reputation for some years because it became a snagging creek. The people would just go up with treble hooks and snag the salmon. But now they enforce new laws and rules where you have to use a single fly or hook. So you can only use a certain amount of weight. It can only be 4 feet above the fly.
Right.
And every year from probably Labor Day until Halloween, salmon run in the Salmon River up in Pulaski, New York. Also with those salmon, well, they're king salmon, coho salmon, and there's also some brown trout and steelheads that will come up with them.
Right.
Because at the end of the salmon run, the brown trout come in there to eat the salmon eggs. And then the steelheads come in and eat the brown trout eggs and the steelhead
right.
and the salmon eggs. So there's an abundance of eggs laying on the bottom of the stream because they all just spawn.
Now, for those that wouldn't know how big those fish might be, give me an idea of pounds, length.
The biggest one caught in Pulaski, I think, was 54 pounds.
Jesus.
Probably about 4 feet long.
That's, that must be a fight.
My biggest was a 34-inch brown trout that weighed 20 pounds and 3 ounces.
That's so amazing.
It's pretty big for a trout.
So in the Berks County area, is there good trout fishing in this area, you feel?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, there's a lot of good trout streams here. Everybody knows. And if you do trout fish, you know almost every stream in Berks County has trout in it. And this time of year, most people don't want to fish. So they think the water's low. They can't. It's not deep hole fishing. There's not many worms in the water. If you go out and fly fish now, though, this is the time to get them. You know, Tulpehocken Creek is a great spot, of course, for the fly stretch. And above the fly stretch, even up into your area.
Yeah, I was going to have to tell them at some point that I fish with Sensei quite a bit here, and we've gotten some trout that's just unbelievable. One was on New Year's Eve at 7:30 at night.
Oh, wow.
And that trout that you caught this past, Christmas Eve.
Yep.
That, I mean, as cold as it was and as dark as it was, we're the only ones out there fishing, and sure enough, we catch fish.
Oh, yeah.
So that's the amazing part of it, is that it's so much of an opportunity that we have Pennsylvania for going some of the best fishing in the world.
Streams.
Right.
We have so many thousand miles of trout streams in Pennsylvania, it's incredible. And I'll say one thing, too, it makes up for idle time. At a time when I was young and I could have gone the wrong way, I was usually busy going fishing.
Same thing with me in the city.
You know,
that's exactly right.
Yep. You know, if you can stay out of the city and stay out of the trouble and find yourself another obsession, it's a good way to go. I mean, a lot of Berks County people do hunt and fish.
Right.
It's pretty much an outdoors place. That's why they even chose here to put Cabela's.
Right.
You know,
well, and the most important thing is getting the kids out off the couch and off the video games and getting them outdoors and doing things like that.
Yeah.
You know, we tried that with the Lehigh Valley Hunting and Fishing Show. We were basically gearing it towards getting kids, you know, outdoors, introducing them to things like the fly tying and things like that. Next thing you know, they're the next ones following in our paths with us.
Wow.
So that's the most amazing thing with this. One lure's in that one box over here is catching my eye. I'm sure people may be seeing that.
The one
right here that's the CCR company lure?
This here?
No, this guy down here on the table.
Down here?
Yeah, right next to that one, in the box there.
Oh,
what's the story on that guy?
Oh, it's just that I have the box. CCR lures, it's a, the creek chub, it's called. This
is a
articulated lure.
Look at that.
That's a beauty.
Look at the beautiful colors in it.
Yeah, I mean, this is all hand-painted. You don't... Now they just make things as simple as they can. This has glass eyes in it. You know, the hooks are all stainless. They have a wire running through them so that the hooks can't pull out of the wood. And, I mean, all the information's with it. And now, like I said, you can find these things. Look in your basement.
Now, what would the approximate value of something like that be if they found that in a basement?
Probably $50.
Imagine that.
For a lure like this. And that's to sell it to a collector. If a person is really a fanatical collector and he can't find one anywhere, I mean, some of these lures are next to impossible to find.
Mm.
and they become less and less. Actually, a lot of them get thrown in dumpsters.
That's a shame.
You know, people clean out grandpa's old stuff.
And they don't realize
and throw it away. And I remember I bought a Fenwick. It's a name brand. It's a popular fishing rod. A Fenwick fiberglass spinning rod at a swap meet, you know, a flea market. I went up to a Korean lady, and I said, "How much for this rod?" And she said, $3. And it was a $45 spinning rod. I said, $3? She said, yes. I said, okay. So she gave it to me, and there was a case with it. She gave me a case. I said, wow, the case came with it, too. I said, is there a lid for the case? Is there a lid for the case? She goes, $2. She thought I didn't want the rod because there was no lid for the case. I mean, it was worth like $50 probably with the rod and the case. But I got it for $2.
That's amazing.
Yeah, and these things, like I said, they get thrown away. Nowadays, people, if they go in and they just look at something like it's an old fishing rod and they throw them away, they don't want to go to Leesport Auction or to Redingers right. or anywhere like that.
Oh, somebody's in they the throw them that's away. Exactly where I got them.
And if you get a graphite fly rod, a Sage or an Orvis or a G. Loomis or a Scott brand, they're worth anywhere from $300 to $1,000. So they're graphite rods, but it's become an expensive sport to do. Reels are very expensive, lines expensive. Even the flies, I'm glad I tie my own because I'm sure some of these guys cry real tears after they lose, you know, 30 or 40 flies throughout a day, get stuck in trees and on rocks, and they cost $2 a piece. That's
well, like
a lot
you were explaining
money.
To me earlier about some of these feathers and what they cost that you're using to tie on these things. I mean, it's amazing what the cost can be.
I mean, feathers have become rare to get and more expensive, actually. Years ago, we used to be able to go hunting. You could shoot a turkey. If you shot a pheasant, you know, if you got a grouse, you had plenty of feathers. You had everything you needed. Now, a pheasant tail is like $5. For a pheasant tail, you know, it's incredible. I mean, the price of what some of the feathers
and
are
probably
and
hours
equipment.
And hours of time to tie these and have them looking exactly what they should be looking like.
Yeah, I mean, you get them down, they become easy after a while. But I said the quality of things goes down. They start putting plastic parts on. They use imitation colors. To imitate a real bug, you need real fur and real feathers.
Right.
Those are the only colors that truly match. Something from a bird will match the color of something that's on an insect.
And the fish know this.
And the fish know, yeah.
They can tell
Now, I think the fish aren't as educated.
Well, that's because the native fish are probably not as easy to have been found.
There's not as many native fish anymore.
But the native fish will probably tell that fake thing in a minute.
Yeah.
Ain't that something? That's unbelievable. Well, Stonefly Guy, I got to thank you for coming on tonight. We're winding down the show here. I know the guy said we got like 2-3 minutes here left on the show.
Oh, really?
Anything you want to share with the public as to where's this going in your eyes as far as this type of a hobby and the collecting of it?
I'm sure a lot of you do it. You know, I'm sure a lot of you guys do. And if you don't, I mean, if you're going to be a fisherman, be a collector. Save some of this heritage here so that the future can see it.
Right, that's
because
important.
If you don't have a past to talk about, there is no future, you know? So that's about it.
Hey, that's cool. As we said, folks, this is why we're here at BCTV, the Pennsylvania Pickers. What we're doing different is we're trying to show you what some of the stuff that could be hidden that you may not have realized the values of it and doing a different topic each month. This is one reason why here at BCTV, we are the number one in local rated TV shows. And with what we're doing each month and some of the props I bring in, it gives you an indication of what we got in store in the future coming months. Now, I know around the corner, September, we're going to do the drag racing show that we missed out on last summer. We know that one's special coming on. We have vintage clothing coming up, some of the little record albums I threw in here, and, you know, like the Platform Elvis shoes and things like that. It's giving you an idea of what we're planning in the next couple months that we're going to be bringing at you. But again, what we're doing is we're not trying to take any money from you, sell you anything. We're trying to educate you what this stuff is worth. This way, if that relative dies and you say, that guy didn't leave me no money. Well, maybe he did leave you money and you didn't realize it. So just think if you had that uncle that he did this type of vintage fishing, you could have tens of thousands of dollars in his basement and not even know it. And that's what the most important thing is. You know, try to do something fun and educational. And this is what I always like to share with everybody. You got to get kids involved because you know what? We're the mentors that lead them down the path to becoming the best adults that they can be. In closing the show, I want to shout out to a few friends. Our guest from last month, Brian, he wants to come back on as my guest host each month, and he absolutely was thrilled to be on the show. I want to give a shout out to the girls there at the Comfort Inn. They're making it pleasurable for people coming in fishing in this area, and they've got the best place in the area to stay. And as we said, we are very lucky and blessed here in Berks County. We've got some of the best trout fishing and other fishing areas that most people don't even realize, and there's monsters out there. I know I've been fishing for probably about 40, 45 years, as well as learning from my sensei over here, but I'm telling you, the fishing is the best way to unwind. There's nothing better than getting out with nature, you know, catching a fish, and even if you don't eat it, you catch and release it like I do. You know, but the main thing of it is, it's good, clean, wholesome fun, and I can't thank you enough for being here with us. This is episode number 7, and without you folks, we won't be able to do this. So we hope you enjoyed tonight's show. We want to wish you well, and everybody be safe. Thank you, and good luck out there fishing. I'm going to go back getting some big ones here again. Let's see what I get. Oh, look at this one. Oh, it's fighting me. Look at that. They're getting me already.